worship and give our God all the praise, the honor, and the glory. You call down into darkness.
Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption. Jesus, you will reign. Shout of praise right now. Let's lift up the name of our God. He is an amazing, amazing God. He makes the darkness tremble. He takes over all opposition. Hallelujah. Ready to have some church today. Come on, let's bow our heads and let's give God our praise right now. Father, we just thank you for today. We thank you for this wonderful privilege to worship you freely with all of us gathered here today. And Father, we just thank you that as the message is spoken to us, that our eyes and ears are open to hear exactly what it is and see exactly what you have for us. And we give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Well, before you're seated, go ahead and greet the person next to you and let them know that you're excited to see them.
I don't know about you, but are you ready to receive the word of God this morning? Amen. I get excited. Sometimes I tell people it's because of the Puerto Rican in me, but it's exciting to get in the Word of God. Actually, it's because of what God has done in my life, the Holy Spirit working in my life. Let us pray before I begin, because I'll get excited and I'll just give prayer and just get right into the Word. I've been doing a lot of praying because I don't dare come up on this pulpit unless God is with me, unless the anointing of the Holy Spirit is with me, and unless His name be glorified. Amen? Father, we just thank you. We praise you for the opportunity to come into your house of worship. We pray that you open our hearts and our minds, and that you speak into our lives what you would want us to hear today, Lord. Let every life be ministered to and every life be changed in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Now, pastor has been speaking to us about the laws of increase, different aspects about the laws of increase. And he asked me to minister about the laws of increase, a servant's heart, having a servant's heart. When you talk, when you speak about increase and you think about increase, you think about prosperity. But I want you to know that off the bat, true prosperity is found in the person of Jesus Christ. True prosperity is found in His Word, and true prosperity is found in having a servant's heart. Pastor also mentioned the other day that for every promise in Scripture, there's a condition. There's a promise, but there's also a condition that we must meet. There's the promise of eternal life and forgiveness of sins in John 3:16, but there's also a condition, which is repent, believe, and receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Not everyone enters eternal life unless you make the decision to follow after Christ. There's the promise of answered prayer, according to Mark 11:24. Jesus said, and we love this, the blessing, the promise, the prayer. Therefore, I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. But then the next verse, Jesus makes it a little tougher for us, and he says, but before you get your answered prayer, before you get the desires of your heart, he says, he has to add this. If you do not forgive, oh no, now we have a problem. If you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive who? Our trespasses. So, Houston, we have a problem. When you forgive, you can't erase the memory, but it helps to free you from the roots of bitterness. When you forgive, you set the captive free, and many times that captive is you, yourself, and I. I always remind couples that, and I love marriage ministry, but I always have to remind couples that no matter how much of a perfect person you think you found, at one time or another, they will fail you. Why? Because Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. When we get to meet each other, we all put on our best behavior, but you don't want to see that other part, okay? So that's why we have to practice the principle of forgiveness. A good marriage is composed of two good forgivers. So if you want to see the law of positive increase in your marriage and grow from level to level and glory to glory, then we need to honor our spouse and watch our tongue. That was for free. This is not a marriage seminar. All right, but I just had to throw that in because I like to meddle sometimes. Galatians 5:13. It says, you have been called into liberty, only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love, it says, by love, serve one another. By love, because you love God, because you love your neighbor, as Jesus said you should. Because Jesus said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. If you have love one towards another, then you've got to show it. You've got to learn to serve one another. Every believer is called to the ministry of servanthood. And we serve God by serving His people. I remember many years ago, these people were in a Bible class, and when they found out it was going to be about serving God by serving people, they walked out very spiritual and says, nope, this is not for us. We only serve God. We don't serve man. Excuse me. By serving God, you have to serve people. That's in the Word. I didn't make it up. So there is a promise in Galatians 6:8. It says, whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. But you've got to sow in the Spirit. And because the condition is, the context of the verse says, whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. You can't sow in the flesh and expect to reap eternal life. When you look at Galatians, and you can do this on your own because we don't have time to look into it, but in Galatians chapter 5, it talks about the works of the flesh and the works of the spirit. So if you're doing things in the flesh and you're speaking in bitterness, in anger, in hatred, in unforgiveness, guess what you're going to reap? It's not going to be eternal life. But if you're reaping in the fruit of the Spirit and putting these principles into practice in your life, it leads to eternal life. Amen? Now, God wants to cause the law of increase in our lives. For what purpose? So that we can do more in the kingdom. When you sow, you are planting seeds that will eventually grow and produce a harvest. If you're sowing the wrong seeds, you're going to produce a different kind of harvest. But you want to produce a harvest that will be a blessing. When you make deposits, and especially in couples, I tell them, people are like banks. You need to make deposits continually. Otherwise, guess what? When you try to withdraw, there's nothing to withdraw from. Because you haven't been depositing love. You haven't been depositing forgiveness. You haven't been depositing, speaking the truth in love. Oh, okay. I forgot. This is not a marriage seminar. All right. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. It says, "For by grace are you saved through faith." I like that word grace because grace, it comes with different meanings. And I like the acronym someone once came up with, GRACE, G-R-A-C-E, God's riches at Christ's expense. It's unmerited favor. And you're saved by God's grace through faith, and it doesn't come from you. It's not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. So if I'm giving this gift to my wife and say, "Honey, I brought you this beautiful T-shirt. Here it is." But, wait. When she goes to reach out for it, I tell her, "No, you can't have it until you work for it. You've got to earn it. You've got to treat me more loving before you get it." She does that already. All right. So it's a gift. It's not of works. In other words, I can't earn it. Otherwise, I'd be boasting on myself. Look what I did. Look at my accomplishments. But it's by God's grace. And even though it's not of works, the next verse, Ephesians 2:10, tells the believer, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus." For what purpose? It says, "For unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should do what? Walk in them." So even though we're not saved by works, works should be a part of our lives. We need to work because we are saved and because of what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. We were created for good works. But in order to perform these good works, there's a mindset that God wants us to have. He desires for us to have. While we live in a world where people like to exalt their positions or titles, God expects his people to be humble. For many, throughout the years, I've met many people who will meet me in churches or wherever. "Oh, you're a Christian?" "Yeah." "Oh, well, so am I." "Well, here's my card. My name is Prophet, Evangelist, Apostle, Doctor, Masters, whatever, and they exalt their title. They exalt their title. But I prefer how the writers of the New Testament letters are identified. We see this with Peter, Timothy, James, Jude. They're all described like the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 1, verse 1. "Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. I'm called to be an apostle, separated into the gospel of God. I have a calling. It's apostleship. But you know what? First and foremost of all, I want you to know that I am a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Forget your degrees. Forget your positions and your titles. You are a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ." But today, in our society, in many churches, we don't want to offend you and say a servant identifies as a slave, so we'll just call you a volunteer. You're all volunteers, all right? But you're actually called a servant, all right? We all need to follow the example of Jesus. So what is that mindset? I'm glad you're asking me because I'm getting ready to answer it. That mindset is found in the book of Philippians chapter, in the book of Philippians. Now, before we get into the book of Philippians, I want you to know that when the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Philippians, do you know where he was? He wasn't in Florida. He wasn't in Hawaii. He was in a prison. He was not enjoying a vacation resort. He was in a jail for 2 years. He was in and out of jail. Was he a criminal? What was his only crime? Preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. People get offended with the good news of Jesus. But when you look at the book of Philippians, the main theme that he's talking about throughout the entire book, 6 chapters, you should read it sometime, it'll bless you. But in 6 chapters, he's constantly referring to joy, having the joy, having rejoicing, a spirit of rejoicing in your life. And the question that needs to be asked, how is it possible for someone who is going through trials and tribulation in his life, he's in jail after jail after jail, and yet he's able to rejoice and have joy in his life? It is only possible through the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. That's why he was able to have this joy. For him, there was no fear in death. And you're like, wow. No fear in death. In Philippians 1:21, he says, "For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." How is that possible? Wait a minute. What's he trying to say that? For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. The reason he could say that was because for me to live, if I live, I'm going to continue to live for Christ. I'm going to continue to preach the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if I die, I will gain because I will be with him forever and ever. He knew the words of Jesus that said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Even though he were dead, yet shall he live." He knew the promises of God. He walked in the Spirit, so he had no fear of death. A jail was just a place where he could worship God regardless of his situation. And you could worship God in the midst of your situation as well. Now, I like teaching with acronyms. As you can see, it's already on the screen. I didn't tell you to put it up there, but good. It's all right. I said the book is full of teachings about joy. And I like this acronym. The J stands for Jesus. The O stands for who? Others. And the Y stands for yourself. For yourself. In order to experience true joy, we must learn to put Jesus who? In what place? First. Others second, and yourself last. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 2, he tells you, he starts explaining to you that there's a mindset that we need to have. And he goes on, he says, "Fulfill ye my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, in humility of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves." I submit to you that if you who are married here, you want a good marriage, learn to esteem your partner, your spouse, your husband, your wife better than yourself. If I'm angry, I'm not angry. I just get excited. All right. But we need to reprioritize our focus, and we need to start fleshing out God's word by esteeming each other better than ourselves. And it goes on in verse 5 about the mindset that we need to have. The Apostle Paul said, "Let this mind be in you." Who's he talking to? The church. It doesn't say, "Let this mind be on the pastor, on the teacher, on the evangelist, on the prophet, on the apostle." No, it's supposed to be in every believer, which was also in Christ Jesus. So there's a mindset that was in our Lord and Savior that the Apostle Paul wants you to get this. He wants you to get this. And it says, who being in the form of God. I love that verse. Who being in the form of God. The word being there in the Greek is hupakon, which means who remaining or never ceasing to be. In other words, he never stopped being God. Our Lord and Savior manifested himself in the flesh over 2,000 years ago. God comes down in the form of man. For what reason? And it says, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Wait a minute, aren't you in the form of God? Don't you exist as God? The church, we believe the Bible teaches the triunity of the Godhead, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's all seen from Genesis to Revelation, where there's a progressive revelation of the divinity of God. Even the first word in Genesis, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God, Elohim, a plural word, meaning more than one is involved. Verse 26 says, let us create man in our image. A plurality, again, is expressed in the us and in the our. So Jesus, in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, because you don't have to rob what's yours already by nature. But he made himself of no reputation. Why? Because he came to glorify the Father. He didn't come to exalt himself, but as he glorified the Father glorifies him. Okay? He makes himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a what? Of a servant. And this is the mindset that a lot of people don't want to accept, but we are all called into the ministry of servanthood and was made in the likeness of men. This is good stuff. I don't know about you. All right? But as we continue reading on in these scriptures, in that same chapter, it says, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death of the cross. So here we have this God-man, the God-man, Jesus Christ. He dies on the cross for our sins. And it says, God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. His name is above Buddha. His name is above Muhammad. His name is above me. His name is above the Pope. He has the name that is above every name. You name it, well, Jesus is above that name. And it says that at his name, I love that. Oh, my gosh. It's not there. Okay, I'll just keep on reading it. That at the name of Jesus, this is what the Bible says. So here this God-man who comes into and becomes a servant, it says, at his name, every knee should bow of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. I want you to picture this. This is what the Bible says for it's going to happen in the future. For everyone who's ever lived, past, present, or future, will one day have to bow their knee to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Every single person, you and I will be there. Hitler will be there. Mussolini will be there. Every person, regardless of their title or their position, they will be bowing their knees to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But the question we have to ask ourselves is, will you be bowing in awe and in reverence or in fear and trembling? I don't know about you, but I prefer bowing in awe and in reverence to our Lord and Savior. He has the name above every name. The law of increase demands that we have the mindset of a servant, one with eternity in mind. Like John the Baptist said, he must increase while I must decrease. In John 12, 26, Jesus said, if any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. If you serve me, I will honor you. My Father will honor you. And what I'm going to share with you briefly is not to brag on myself, but to exalt God. Exalt what he's done in our lives. Many years ago, in 1999 when I was coming to move to Florida. A lot of people come here to retire. I came from New York. I didn't want to move to Florida, but things kept happening to confirm that I belonged here for a purpose. And I was fighting it. I was like Jonah, no, I will not move to Florida. I have a great job there. I'm secure there. And I love the nasty people. I mean, the and the traffic, driving, people cutting you off every minute, you know, but I love New York. But the Lord confirmed, this is where I want you. And I'm like, okay, Lord. But Lord, you know, now the doors are opening. I land the job, but I'm scared. I'm like, God, are you really in this? You're confirming this. I don't want to move to Florida, but you're the one leading me, and I'm fighting you, and I have to stop fighting, and I'm accepting it. But God, I'm taking a big pay cut. I'm taking a big pay cut. And I didn't tell anybody. Only my wife knew, and I knew. And then our pastor in New Jersey, he found out we were moving, and he says, hey, he announced it to the congregation, and he said, these people have been faithful here for many years. They've served as greeters. They've served in children's ministry. They're elders of our church. They're doing whatever in all the years we were there. And he's never done this before, a church of thousands. But he says, I want you to bless them today. I didn't expect this blessing. I wasn't asking, Pastor, can you please give me some money? You know, so I'm not like that. We don't knock on people's doors. And all of a sudden, people just started coming and giving. I didn't have room in my pockets. My wife, her pocketbook said, honey, I don't have room. My kids were holding on to checks too and money. The ushers had to bring a garbage bag. And we went home with a wonderful garbage bag with $14,000 in it. And I'm like, wow. I was concerned, but God said, you serve me, I will honor you. I will honor you. And another time when we were here in Florida, and you know, now the money's being depleted. And I remember my kids were opening the fridge and closing it every few minutes. I'm like, oh my gosh, we need food. We need food. And I didn't know that my salary back then I earned for a family of five, I fell below the poverty level. And I didn't know about food banks or whatever, you know. So I was like, wow. And I felt horrible. And then all of a sudden I get a check in the mail. A lady says, hey, you were a teacher of mine like a year and a half ago in New Jersey, and I've taught hundreds and hundreds of people throughout the years. I don't know who this lady was, but she sent this check for $1,000. And I'm like, wow, praise the Lord. This comes in real handy. Another time, and like I said, I'm not saying this to brag. You know that I'm so spiritual, God only blesses me. But it happened throughout the time I was here, just little things. One time I was even thinking a thought. I'm locking up the church in Fort Myers, and I just thought, it wasn't even a prayer. And I just said, I need at least $50 till payday. And I'm locking up the church, and there was a first-time visitor, first and last. I never saw her again. And she was getting into her car, and she walks back into the church and said, the Lord just told me to give you this. And when I looked at it, it was a $50 bill. I didn't even pray about it. But God knew my need before I even prayed. And I was like, and sometimes when I think about that one little blessing, it's $50. It wasn't a big amount. But it humbles me, and it breaks me into tears sometimes. Like, wow, God blessed that woman who I never saw again in my life. You know, but she heard the Holy Spirit. And one of the biggest testimonies we have, I want you to go to the about our debt cancellation. This happened in 2014. My wife got this in the mail, and she says, honey, it looks like we got a big bill in the mail. They want us to pay our second mortgage off. We owe $35,793.90, but on the right it says cancellation of debt. And I was like, what? We haven't applied for this. How did this happen? You know, and I wasn't about to call them and say, hey, can you give me an explanation? I want to pay the $35,000. And I just received it. I said, honey, I'm not going to. It says it's canceled. They never came after us, so it's canceled. The second mortgage was paid off. And I was like, yes, praise the Lord. You know, if any man serve me, him will my Father honor. God is a faithful God. And I'm going to leave you with 4 points as soon as I drink some water. Are you all awake? Okay, we'll do another hour then. We'll have third service. Wait outside. 4 points I want you to walk away with. Point number one, servanthood is God's work for every believer. It's not just for the pastor, the teacher, the evangelist. It's for every believer. We are all called into a spirit of servanthood. Matthew chapter 9, Jesus, I love Jesus. Matthew chapter 9, verse 37 through 38. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his field. I submit to you, body of Christ, that it's time to stop praying and start doing. We need to all become laborers in his field. There's things you don't have to pray about. I don't have to pray about loving my wife. If I don't love her, she'll let me know. So I wake up every morning and I say, what can I do today to love my wife? What can I do today to serve my Lord? Amen. And many times serving him involves loving others and loving your spouse. Okay, where was we? Point number two. Servanthood is how God carries his work for increase. One of the main reasons that we exist as the body of Christ, as a church, is for this purpose, found in Matthew chapter 28. Matthew 28, which says, Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. There's the triune Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe some of the things that I said to you. No, it says all. All things I have commanded you. That's what we need to obey. Jesus taught his disciples that we are to duplicate ourselves in this text, which is commonly known as the Great Commission. But it's unfortunate that many times we believers forget what the Great Commission is all about, and we eliminate the letter C from commission, and it becomes what? An omission. We are all called to duplicate ourselves, and it holds true today. So this means that the body of Christ has a challenge, a responsibility in reaching the world with the message of salvation, and that includes with your time, talents, and treasure, and this is servanthood. We cannot do it without you. So the problem is, Houston, we have a problem. Statistics indicate that only 5 out of every believers make any attempt to share their faith. So we need you. We need the other 95%. All right? Servanthood, point number 3, is essential for our increased spiritual growth. We saw in Ephesians 2:10 that we were created for good works to walk in them. For many years, I kept hearing that I had a ministerial calling upon my life. But it was dormant because I kept making excuses. I don't want to be a minister. If you know that I have that calling, great for you, but I don't want it. And the problem is that many of us have talents, abilities that are lying dormant, and we're not using it for the kingdom. There's a poem that I found many years ago in a Bible that someone gave me, and it goes like this. I cannot be your servant, Lord. There's much that keeps me home. I have a mortgage and a family, a place I call my own. I cannot be your servant, Lord. I've brought a piece of land. I've got to go and check it out. I just hope you'll understand. I cannot be your servant, Lord. I've brought myself a cow and a cattle ranch just north of here. We're heading up there now. I cannot be your servant, Lord. My father has just died. We've got to go and bury him, and I just can't leave my mother's side. I'm not a public speaker, Lord. That's why I cannot serve. For me to stand in front of crowds, I simply lack the nerve. I cannot be your servant, Lord. I married me a wife. She's a stay-at-home type person. She's lived here all her life. One by one, they came to him with excuses that they made. And one by one, he turned aside, and this is what he said. Thousands are in need of me throughout this hurting earth. Your neighbors and your friends are needing the new birth. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So my question is, what's holding us back? What's holding us back? Point number 4, servanthood is essential for us to use our spiritual gifts. It is essential to use our spiritual gifts. I want you to skip Romans chapter 12 slide, and we'll just go to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. 1 Peter 4:10, good. It says each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. So we are called to use our gifts to serve who? Others. That's right. This law of increase, having a servant's heart, is all about loving service performed in the power of the Spirit. For what purpose? To meet the temporal and spiritual needs of those around us. Not looking for recognition, but rather leaving the results to God. May we all seek to be servants of the Most High. I've said all of this to let you know that we need you. This church, every church in the country and around the world needs servants to serve in the church. Okay, you have a calling to be a servant. We need people as ushers, as greeters, in Spanish translation, in the media, in sound. We need the guitar players, bass players, and the list goes on. And I like this T-shirt I've been seeing people in our church wearing. It says, we can do more together. We can do more together. Preaching the gospel is a commitment that we all make. Being a servant to serve the Lord is a commitment that we all make. And we're asking people, you know, you don't have to be a member of the church. You don't have to take growth class right now. We're revamping those classes. They will begin to start sometime in September. Right now, there's no growth classes, but if you want to serve in any area of the ministry, we're asking you that you please go to the information desk, give them your name, a telephone number, email address, what areas of the ministry you might be interested in, or if you don't know, we can help you and send you information so you can know what's available out there and how you can use some of your gifts. But I want to end with a scripture verse in Matthew chapter 25. Jesus said these words. Matthew chapter 25. If I can find it, it's in the New Testament somewhere. Okay. Here, Matthew 25. Here we go. 25:23. It says, his Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Amen. May we all consider serving the Lord with our time, with our talents, and with our treasure. Let us pray. I want to ask right now, if you're here today and you have never committed your life to Jesus Christ, we want you to repeat this prayer after me. But when you repeat the prayer after me, we need you to mean it from the bottom of your heart, because it does you no good to just repeat a prayer unless you mean it. If you've never confessed, received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want everyone praying with me, no one looking around. Dear Lord Jesus, I know I have sinned and stand in need of forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I repent from all sins and receive you as my Lord and my Savior. In your name I pray. Amen.
We hope you've enjoyed this message. For more media resources and other information, visit us online at naplechurch.com.